started. For those of you who I don't know, I see lots of friendly faces here. I'm Steve Slick. I'm the Director of the Intelligence Studies Project at the University. Welcome to today's conversation on national security leadership. And so before I call on my friend and our guest today, I'd like to just make a few program announcements for the ISD. Many of you, I think, were with us yesterday last week over at the LBJ Library. We had a great session with David Priest. We talked about his trip and book on the presidency. Today, obviously, we have an engaging guest and a timely set of topics that we can sink our teeth into. And our next event, and this is what I want to announce today, if I may, is the annual spring symposium that the Intelligence Studies Project puts on. This will be March 23rd. It will be held down at the Edgar Harbin Alumni Center. And the topic this year is intelligence in defense of the homeland. And so this event will include keynote remarks by Jim Comey, the FBI director, and Tom Bossert, who's President Trump's new Homeland Security and Counterterrorism advisor. Tom is a former colleague of ours at the White House, and these may well be his first public remarks, so I think it's that will be an interesting event. So it will be posted this afternoon on the ISP website. Registration will also open there. The attendance is capped at about 250 or so. I suspect this is going to be a pretty tough ticket. So if you'd like to go, you should probably check the site later today. So before we get going here, let me just thank the staff of the Strauss Center, the Clements Center, and the Intelligence Studies Project again. They did a great job organizing these events. And then I also want to acknowledge the our partners today, the American Enterprise and Campus Group. There's information available somewhere on a table, outside, inside?
Yeah.
Okay, outside on a table, there's information from the on the American Enterprise Institute. Including lists of their full-time positions and internship opportunities. So if you'd like to learn more about AEI, please grab some of those materials. So we'll follow our normal format for today. In other words, we're going to ask our speaker to entertain us with remarks of his choosing for 30 or 45 minutes at the most, and then we'll open up the floor to questions. So today we're privileged to host Marc Thiessen. Marc is a resident fellow of the American Enterprise Institute, columnist for the Washington Post, and the co-founder of Oval Office Writers. Marc served in the George W. Bush administration, first as a speechwriter to Secretary of Defense Donald Rumsfeld, and later as a speechwriter to the president himself. And so, what else do I want to say about Marc? Oh, yeah. Since I'm carrying this around, I should mention it. In addition to those functions I described to you, Marc is also the author of a bestseller that was released in 2010, Courting Disaster, How the CIA Kept America Safe and How Barack Obama is Inviting the Next Attack. And I had the pleasure of working with Marc on the White House staff, and I can testify that he's smart, passionate, deeply committed to our national security. And I dare say that if the CIA's clandestine service had a honorary membership, I suspect Marc would be one of the first people inducted into that society. So please welcome Marc.
Thank you very much, Steve. Great to be with you here. I've just flown in from Washington, D.C., or some people like to call it 46 square miles surrounded by reality. I was going to say, it's good to be, thank you for inviting me to visit reality, but then I realized I'm in Austin, Texas. I am particularly pleased to be here with two dear friends from my White House days, Will Bowden and Steve Slick. They're two of the smartest, best people I know in government, and if you're a student here, you're very lucky to have them teaching you. During our time in the White House, Steve and I established what I think was probably an unprecedented and never since repeated collaboration between the presidential speechwriting office and the intelligence community. President Bush was very determined when one of his great responsibilities he thought when he came into office was to keep the American people informed about a new and unprecedented war against a new and unprecedented that many people didn't understand. And he directed us to declassify a lot of intelligence. To explain that struggle and that enemy to the American people. And not a week went by where President Bush didn't give either a speech or have an event of some kind explaining to the American people with how we were doing in that war, what the consequences of victory were, what the consequences of defeat would be, and updating them on our progress on the battlefield. So he had us declassify a lot of intelligence. So Steve would invite me over to the NSC and put me in a room with the subject matter experts from the CIA, who would give me an unvarnished intelligence briefing on what was happening. And I would write a speech on a classified computer and give it to Steve, and he would send it through the process of declassification. And that was often a heartbreaking experience for a speechwriter, because they gave me the unvarnished truth, and I would put stuff in the speech, and then Steve would have to come back to me and say, no, we can't actually tell that story, or no, we can't actually tell that story, and here's why. But we did, and some of them were, you know, President Bush famously said that some of our greatest victories were secret even in success, and unfortunately some of those stories had to stay secret. I would love to share them, but it was important for protecting sources and methods. But we did declassify a lot of information, and I think we achieved we did a lot in terms of informing the American people about what was happening in the war on terror. And so I'm grateful to you both for having me here today. As Steve indicated, I've had a fascinating career. I've worked for some of the most greatest conservative leaders in our nation's history, from Donald Rumsfeld and Dick Cheney to George W. Bush. I served in government at the dawn of the War on Terror and saw that war up close, from the planning rooms of the Pentagon to the Oval Office to the major battlefield. I was in the Pentagon on September 11, 2001. I was blessed to be a few quarters down from the point of impact, but I felt the building shake. I smelled the smoke. My wife Pam was 8 months pregnant at the time with our first child, and phone lines were down. No cell phones were communicating, and so she didn't know for most of the day whether her unborn child still had a father. And in the months that followed, I traveled about 250,000 miles around the world with Secretary Rumsfeld between over 50 countries, including his first visit to Afghanistan after U.S. forces liberated the country, his first visit to Iraq after the toppling of Saddam Hussein. I vividly recall landing at Bagram Air Base in outside Kabul, probably, you know, about 6 or 7 weeks after the 9/11 attacks, that had recently been vacated by Taliban forces. The place was scattered with the carcasses of MiG fighters. In fact, if you've ever been on a military base, you see how they make you drive through a barricade where they put up these concrete barriers in to go in a zigzag pattern. They didn't have concrete there, but they had MiG engines, so they made the barriers out of MiG engines. So you think these things probably cost $1 million a piece back in the day, and now they're barriers for trucks. But we met with Afghan resistance leaders in an old blown-out Soviet hangar, plotting the next steps in the campaign to drive Al-Qaeda out of the sanctuary where they planned the 9/11 attack. The years that followed, I traveled with him many times, back to Afghanistan, to Iraq, to any other country. Rumsfeld would often visit two or three countries in a day. So we went from Afghanistan to Pakistan to Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Uzbekistan, Turkmenistan. We used to call them our one-night stand tools. And I moved on to the White House, was the lead writer on two State of the Union addresses, traveled the world with the president, working on speeches in the Oval Office on Air Force One. And as Steve will attest to you, when you work at the White House, it never gets old. There's never a day that you don't walk into that building and just, you know, be amazed and look up and wonder at that place. Every time I came in and sat down at my desk in the West Wing, I sort of had to pinch myself. I almost expected that a Secret Service agent would walk in and say, Mr. Thiessen, that's been a terrible mistake. Please come with us. But I truly had a front row seat to history. And today I'm a columnist at the Washington Post, where I have precious conservative real estate in one of the nation's great liberal newspapers. I'm a commentator on Fox News. And I work at the place of my intellectual home, the place where my conservative heart beats, and that's the American Enterprise Institute. AEI, we believe passionately in the equality of human dignity and the right of every person to realize his or her potential. Like many of you in this room, I came from immigrants. My mother was a stateless refugee after World War II, and as a teenage girl, she fought in the 1944 Warsaw Uprising against the Nazis, where the Polish resistance took back the Polish capital for 66 days. And after Warsaw fell, she was taken prisoner of war to Germany, was liberated by Patton's army, and then stayed in London after the war because her family told her it wasn't safe to come back to Poland because Nazi occupation had been replaced by communist tyranny and Soviet domination. And so she put herself in medical school, learning English while she learned medicine, and eventually made her way to New York City, which is where I was born. And when she arrived in New York, like so many immigrants, she saw the Statue of Liberty. As you all know, the statue has at its base a poem, The New Colossus. And it exhorts the world, give me your tired, your poor, your huddled masses, yearning to breathe free, the wretched refuse. of your teeming shore. At the American Enterprise Institute, we take that those words aren't just rhetoric. We take those words very seriously. How many of you have seen the movie Stripes with Bill Murray? One of the greatest movies of all time. If you haven't seen it, go rent it right now, as soon as you leave this room. But it's a movie about a bunch of social misfits who are trying to make it through Army basic training. And there's the scene where they're about to go out and march on the field, and they've fallen asleep through training, and they're all dressed in uniforms and not prepared. And Bill Murray gives them this rallying speech, and this is what he says to them. He says, "We're Americans with a capital A. You know what that means? That means our forefathers were kicked out of every decent country in the world. We are the wretched refuse. We are the underdog. We're mutts." And I think that is the best description of what it means to be an American that I've ever heard. We're mutts. We are, if what sets America apart is that we are all descended from what our president, Arthur Brooks, at the AAI calls the stock of ambitious riffraff. People who came to our shores from all over the world, determined to live a life of dignity and potential, no better or worse than anybody else. And that is what we fight for at AI. We fight for, our motto is freedom, opportunity, and enterprise for everyone. If you want to understand the power of free enterprise, what it has done to the world, consider a couple of statistics. From between 1990 and 2013, so the quarter century following the collapse of Soviet communism, when freedom and free markets spread across the globe, the number of people living in extreme poverty dropped by more than half, from 1.85 billion in 1990 to 770 million today. Put that another way, since 1990, the number of people living in extreme poverty has been dropping by a staggering 130,000 people every single day. Think about what that means. When you wake up tomorrow morning, there will be 130,000 people in the world not living in extreme poverty who were the day before, and every day after that, and every day after that, and every day after that. Not only that, in 1990, one out of every three people in the world was illiterate. Today it's 15%. In 1990, there were 2.3 billion people living in democracies. By 2015, that number had nearly doubled to 4.1 billion, more than every second person in the world. And of those still living in autocracy, 4 out of 5 live in China. So take China out of the equation, the vast majority of the world's people live in democratic societies. So that progress is nothing short of stunning. The world is freer, more literate, more prosperous than at any time in human history. And all that happened in just a quarter century, in the span of a single generation. It's amazing. Now, as Arthur Brooks likes to ask the question, how did that remarkable transformation take place? Was it the fabulous success of the United Nations? International Monetary Fund, the Obama-style stimulus projects, government spending? No, it was none of those things. It was freedom and free enterprise. That's what's created this enormous and remarkable progress. And that's what AEI's mission is to defend freedom and free enterprise around the world. And so while the world has never been more freer or more prosperous, those are facts, it's also never been more dangerous. And that's what I focus on in my work at AEI. And the dangers we face in the months and years ahead may not be necessarily the ones that we're all focused on today, or the ones that you're studying in your classrooms even. We're now just a month into a new administration in Washington. We have a new commander-in-chief with little experience in national security, who may at any moment have to lead our nation through an unprecedented and unanticipated national security crisis. It's happened before. In 1988, during the presidential debates, no one asked either of the candidates about Iraq. Yet, very soon after the election, Iraq invaded Kuwait, and we were engaged in the Persian Gulf War, a very new and unprecedented war. In 2000 presidential debates, no one asked either of the candidates about Al-Qaeda. A few months after the election, we had the 9/11 attack, and the American homeland was attacked, and we were engaged in a new and unprecedented war against terror. The fact is, since the end of the Cold War, every American president has sent American troops into harm's way in a conflict he didn't anticipate. And so it's entirely possible, if not likely, that President Trump will face a global crisis that none of us are expecting today and no one asked him about during the 2016 campaign. So knowing this history, right before the election, I asked a number of leading national security experts, some former officials, some of my brilliant AEI colleagues, what they thought was the one question no one had asked the candidates that could come to dominate the next president's term in office. And their answers were fascinating and quite frankly terrifying. Several pointed to Pakistan as the epicenter of what might be the next major international crisis. Former CIA and NSA director Mike Hayden asked this, Pakistan is making nuclear weapons faster than any other country on Earth, and it's as its society becomes more violent, more radicalized, and more anti-American. Pakistan can be fairly described as ambitious, fragile, and nuclear. When it comes to stability and overall health, the Fund for Peace rates it as 14th from the bottom of the world's nations, comfortably tucked in between Burundi and Nigeria. What happens if Pakistan fractures? Former Undersecretary of Defense for Policy Eric Edelman pointed out that Pakistan had, quote, adopted a nuclear doctrine like Russia's that foreseals battlefield use of low-yield or short-range weapons. And a nuclear confrontation or nuclear war between India and Pakistan would be the most likely route to terrorists getting hold of a functioning nuclear weapon. What, he asked, will the new president do if that happens? Other experts pointed to the possibility of a attack on our critical infrastructure. There's a brilliant former national security staffer and 28-year veteran of the CIA's clandestine service asked this question. How will the president respond to a foreign cyber attack directed against critical government or private target early in his term? The president's handling of such an early test will define for our adversaries, allies, and the American people how the government intends to defend our interests in this rapidly evolving realm. That guy is Steve Slick. My American Enterprise Institute colleague, Mackenzie Eaglin, suggested an infrastructure attack could come not from cyberspace, but from outer space. China, Russia, and others are developing and testing missiles and spacecraft to destroy and manipulate our satellite constellation, she says. Technology which will allow our financial markets to trade in milliseconds, enable our cars and phones to help us get from point A to point B, and undergird the entirety of the U.S. military. How, she asks, will the next president deter or fight back against a Russian or Chinese one-day space satellite? Others suggested the crisis could come from East Asia. Former CIA Director John McLaughlin asked, how would you respond if there were a collision between Japanese and Chinese military forces in the East China Sea, a disputed area the two countries patrol in close proximity? If some sort of military action ensued, Japan, a U.S. treaty ally, could call on the U.S. for help in combating China. What would the new president do? Imagine having to make that decision. 2 weeks ago, North Korea test-fired a missile into the Sea of Japan. Misha Oslin, who's a director of Japan studies, asked, what if that missile landed not in the Sea of Japan, but an accidental misfire that went into Japan proper? What would the president do if that happened? Several experts raised frightening scenarios involving Tehran. Former CIA chief legal officer John Rizzo asked, what would the president do if Iran decides to immediately test the new president and the resolve of Washington's commitment to the nuclear deal by taking provocative, high-profile act against the U.S. government in the region, such as kidnapping diplomats or American citizens? His prediction's already starting to come true. The Iranians already are probing the Trump administration for signs of weakness, testing a ballistic missile in the first weeks of his administration. What if they escalate that in the months ahead? Then there's Russia. John McLaughlin again asks, what would the president do if Vladimir Putin used a version of his Crimea and Ukraine tactics in a NATO country that has a large Russian-speaking population, such as Estonia or Latvia? Imagine if he stopped short of moving in Russian forces, but manages to foment unrest among that population by covert tactics, creating a measure of protest and instability. And imagine this leads to the effective country to invoke Article 5 of the NATO Treaty, which calls on NATO countries to come to the defense of the members under threat. How would the president handle that? The potential crises and challenges are endless. What if Saudi Arabia collapses and the Persian Gulf region is thrown into chaos? Thanks to 8 years of defense cuts, we no longer have a two-war strategy. We only have a one-war capability. What if we have a phase two at the same time? Last year, ISIS launched a chemical weapons attack against a U.S. base in northern Iraq. What if they try to do that in Europe or the United States? And while we're distracted by ISIS, what if al-Qaeda comes after us again when we're not paying attention? Those are terrifying questions. And those are only the potential crises we know about. My old boss, Secretary Rumsfeld, famously said, when it comes to national security threats, there are known knowns, there are known unknowns, and there are unknown unknowns. Right? So known knowns are the things we know, like the fact that China's building military bases in disputed islands in the South China Sea. Then there are known unknowns, the things we know we do not know. Like, for example, what is the intent of Iran's leaders in terms of breaking out as a nuclear power? And then there are the unknown unknowns, the things that we know we don't know. We don't know we don't know. Those are the really scary ones. Those are the ones that students here are studying and should be keeping them up at night. The unknown unknowns. Here's what I worry most about myself, and I take all those threads that my brilliant colleagues and friends have laid out. My worry is that our feckless response to the terrorist threat over the last 8 years has not only increased the danger of a mass casualty attack here in the United States, it has emboldened all the other threats I just described and all the other actors around the world that are looking at us. and accelerated the danger from those threats and also from the unknown unknowns out there. People watch us, and they watch when we react, how we react to international crises. They watch how we deal with ISIS. Hamas is watching, Hezbollah is watching, North Korea is watching, China is watching, Russia is watching. For the past 8 years, we have projected weakness in the world. And as a result, the Trump administration has inherited a world in chaos, and one which is probably the most dangerous any president has inherited in recent history. In his press conference last week, President Trump said, "I inherited a mess." He's absolutely right, especially when it comes to the battle against Islamic radicalism. Before leaving office, President Obama officials brag that they had taken back more than 45% of the territory previously controlled by ISIS in Iraq. Sounds like progress, right? It's pretty good, 45%. That is great news, but here's the problem. That's like a patient who ignored a lung cancer diagnosis, bragging that he finally reduced the tumor in his lung by almost half, glossing over the fact that he waited for years to get treatment and let it spread and metastasize to all his other organs. If President Obama had acted, first of all, if he had left American troops in Iraq, as his military advisors suggested, ISIS would have never risen up. But if he had acted early to stop the Islamic State cancer from spreading, he could have stopped it. But instead, he dismissed the terrorist group as the JV team that, quote, did not pose a direct threat to us, unquote. And while he delayed action, the cancer spread in Syria, it spread in Iraq, and now it's spread and metastasized all across the world. And consider this, in 2015, President Obama's director of Central Intelligence, or CIA director, rather, that's not the proper term anymore, said when Obama took office, ISIS was, quote, pretty much decimated, unquote, and had maybe 700 or so adherents. 700. He added, it grew up quite a bit in the past several years. That's about the understatement of the decade. ISIS has tens of thousands of members in Iraq and Syria. They're estimated to have about 5,000 fighters in Libya. They've established a presence in 18 countries around the world and declared provinces in Algeria, Libya, Egypt, Nigeria, Saudi Arabia, Yemen, and Pakistan. Washington Post recently reported that, quote, since the withdrawal of most units and international troops, the Islamic State has steadily made inroads in Afghanistan, where it has, quote, poured pepper into the wounds of enemies, seared their hands in vats of boiling oil, blindfolded, tortured, and blown apart villagers with explosives buried underneath them. But ISIS in Afghanistan is so brutal that it actually makes people long for the days of retirement. That's how bad these people are. CNN analysis reports that since 2014, when President Obama dismissed them as the JV team, ISIS has carried out or inspired 143 attacks in 23 countries outside of Iraq and Syria that have killed 2,043 people and injured thousands more. And their caliph, their leader, Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi, has warned that they are coming after us. In a audio address a couple of years ago, he said, and this is a quote, "Our last message is to the Americans. Soon we will be in direct confrontation, and the sons of Islam have prepared for such a day. So watch, for we are with you watching. We are with you watching. We are here." They're determined to follow through on that threat and bring violence that we are witnessing on our TV screen here to our shores. And while America and the world have been distracted by the fight against ISIS, Al-Qaeda, the terror network that planned and executed the 9/11 attacks, has been expanding its influence. It turns out that Al-Qaeda was not on the path to defeat, as President Obama told us. To the contrary, they were growing for the past 8 years in Syria, Yemen, Tunisia, Libya, and other parts of North Africa. General Jack Keane, the general who designed the surge in Iraq, recently testified before Congress that Al-Qaeda has grown fourfold in the last 5 years. They are not down. They are not out. They have made a tactical decision to lay low, bide their time, and let us focus on their rival, ISIS, while they wait for the opportunity to reemerge and strike us. It is true that our defenses are better today than they were before September 11, 2001, thanks to the work of people like Steve and his colleagues in the Central Intelligence Agency and the other institutions of government. But it's also true that the terrorist danger is far more complex and in many ways more dangerous than it was before September 11, 2001. Before 9/11, we faced largely a threat from one terrorist network, Al-Qaeda, that had sanctuary in one country, Afghanistan. That was the main threat we faced. Today we face the danger of not one, but two major terrorist networks, ISIS and Al-Qaeda, who have safe havens in dozens of countries. Moreover, we face a new dynamic that we have never experienced in the battle against terror, which is free market competition among the Islamic radicals. We have a rivalry between two Islamic terror networks, ISIS and the original Al-Qaeda, who are competing for followers among the jihadi faithful, and importantly, cash from the jihadi financiers. And both of them know that the way to win that competition is to be the first one to carry out a successful mass casualty attack against the United States of America. So what do we do about it? First, We need to stop droning every terrorist we find. The Obama administration essentially stopped capturing, detaining, and questioning terrorist leaders to find out what their plans are. It simply began vaporizing them with drones. I'm not against drone strikes. I'm not against vaporizing terrorists. But the problem with vaporizing terrorists is that when you vaporize a senior Al-Qaeda leader or ISIS leader, you vaporize all the actionable intelligence in their brains. Dead terrorists cannot tell you their plans for new attacks. We need that information to keep the country safe. Unlike traditional enemies, terrorists have no armies or navies or air forces that you can watch from the sky, from satellites. It's 19 guys with box cutters on 9/11, or a handful of terrorists with automatic weapons in Paris, or a guy grabbing a truck in Nice and running over hundreds of people on the street. You can't stop that with intelligence from satellites. You need human intelligence. And the only way to stop them is to get the terrorists to tell you their plans. Now, there are different ways to get them to tell you your plans. You can listen to their communications. There's intercepts, infiltration, and interrogation, the three eyes of human intelligence, right? You can intercept their communications and listen to them. That's a lot harder to do thanks to Edward Snowden, who I understand some people in this community think is a hero, but he's not. He did enormous damage to our ability to listen in on our terrorist enemies and plot to find their plans. You can infiltrate. That was very hard to do after 9/11 because of policies that have been put in place before that made it very hard for us to deal with people. We had almost no contact within the Islamic radical world because of what's called the Deutsch rules. But we've gotten better at that. But that's necessarily a hard thing to do because when someone comes to you or you recruit somebody, you don't necessarily know who they are or if they really are who they're saying. Or when you intercept a phone call or an email message, you don't necessarily know who the people are, and they're speaking in code, and they know we're listening and we're not trying to intercept them. So how did we figure out who were real people who could really trust, who were really double agents, who could work with us, and how do we know who you're listening to? We used to ask the terrorists. We had a terrorist think tank in the CIA black sites. We would go to Khalid Sheikh Mohammed and play him a recording of an intercepted phone call, and he would say, oh yeah, this means this, and that means that, and that's the voice, I recognize that voice, that's so-and-so. Or we would have recruited an operative, and we would go to Khalid Sheikh Mohammed and say, is this guy really who he says he is? And he would say, oh yeah, he's so-and-so, and he used to work for me, or he'd say, he's not, interrogation is the only interactive form of human intelligence, where in other forms of human intelligence, you're listening, but you can't ask questions, or you're not sure who they are. We need the ability to and find out what they know. Second thing we need to do is we need to follow the principles set forth by the Bush administration at the start of the war on terror, which is fight them over there so we do not have to face them here. We have been very reluctant to do that. Secretary Mattis, there are reports that he said that he's considering sending ground troops to Syria to fight ISIS. That would be a welcome change, and it would have the support of the American people. Quinnipiac poll recently found 62% of Americans support sending ground troops to Iraq to fight the Islamic State in both Iraq and Syria. Only 30% of Americans were opposed to that. Among Republicans, support for boots on the ground is 73%. Among independents, it's 60%. And here's the stunning part. 53% majority of Democrats support sending ground troops to Iraq and Syria to fight ISIS. Americans are not squeamish about what needs to be done. They understand the threat. They remember 9/11. Unfortunately, we have voices on the left and the right who are telling us that the lesson of 9/11 is that we should be avoid being drawn into battles in faraway places. And I think even our president has said as much himself. So this is not just a critique of the left, it's a critique of the current administration. They say that Al-Qaeda attacked us on 9/11 because they wanted to draw us into Afghanistan. Have you heard this argument? They wanted to draw us in, and ISIS now wants to do the same thing in Iraq and in Syria. That is dead wrong. And how do I know that? Because the mastermind of 9/11, Khalid Sheikh Mohammed, told us that it was wrong. Let me conclude with a story. One of my proudest experiences during my time at the White House was helping craft President Bush's speech revealing the existence of the CIA's enhanced interrogation program. This is one of the first speeches that Steve and I collaborated on during my time in the White House. And it was a program so secret I had to write the speech on a top secret computer that wasn't even connected to the CIPRNet, the classified internet, and it was housed in a secure facility at the NSC. If Hillary Clinton had tried that, she might be president. But I was given access to all the top secret intelligence produced that program, and I got to know the interrogators, the men and women who actually sat across from Khalid Sheikh Mohammed and got him to tell us his plans for follow-on attacks. When Khalid Sheikh Mohammed was captured, he was defiant. when he was asked about his plans for new attacks, he said, "Soon you will know. Soon you will know." He said Americans are weak, decadent, didn't have the will to do what was necessary to stop him and his movement from attacking us. And when he was asked again, he said, "I'll tell you everything when I get to New York and see my lawyer." He didn't go to New York and he didn't get a lawyer. He went to a CIA black site, where he went very quickly from a state of defiance to a state of cooperation. Before he underwent enhanced interrogation, he refused to answer questions. After, he became a confident clinician. He became what one CIA official described as an Al-Qaeda management consultant for the CIA. He held classes for CIA officers with a whiteboard where he would draw schematics of how Al-Qaeda moved money, how it picked operatives, how it picked targets, how it used communications, all of the secrets of how they operate. He provided actionable intelligence that led to the capture of pretty much all of the members of his cell and other cells that he had recruited, and also information that led us to Osama bin Laden. But in addition to actionable intelligence, he also told the CIA a lot about what motivated the terrorists. One of his interrogators was a man named Dr. Jim Mitchell. Jim has just published a gripping new memoir called Enhanced Interrogation: Inside the Minds and Motives of the Islamic Terrorists Trying to Destroy America. It's a great book, and I encourage you to read it. I recently had Jim over at AEI for an event and an interview, and Jim spent thousands of hours with Khalid Sheikh Mohammed speaking the way we are today across the table, and other Al-Qaeda leaders, and he shared in that book and in that interview what KSM told him. And here's what KSM told him about the 9/11 attacks. KSM said they were not trying to draw us into Afghanistan, quite the opposite. He said Al-Qaeda expected us to respond just to 9/11, just like we did the 1983 bombing of the Marine barracks in Beirut, Lebanon, where KSM said America, quote, turned tail and ran, unquote. He said the Clinton administration did the same thing after Al-Qaeda bombed two U.S. embassies in East Africa and attacked the USS Cole in the port of Aden, Yemen. Clinton fired a few missiles at abandoned training camps, he said, and Al-Qaeda was essentially unharmed, leaving him free to advance his plans for the 9/11 attacks. KSM told Jim he assumed the United States would treat the 9/11 attacks the same way, arresting some operatives, firing a few missiles, but unwise leaving him free to plan the second wave, his plan for follow-on attacks. Indeed, he said this was the reason behind Al-Qaeda's assassination of Northern Alliance leader Ahmad Shah Massoud right before the 9/11 attacks. Massoud was the leader of the Northern Alliance, which was the rivals of the Taliban in Afghanistan, and Al-Qaeda took him out in exchange for a promise from Mullah Omar that they would not extradite Al-Qaeda leaders to the United States after the 9/11 attacks. So think about that. Before 9/11, KSM and his terrorist collaborators were actively preparing to fight extradition. They thought they were going to be indicted. Then KSM said to Jim, and this is a direct quote, "How was I supposed to know that cowboy, George Bush, would announce he wanted us dead or alive and invade Afghanistan and hunt us down?" That was what KSM said. He explained that if the United States had done that, if we had treated 9/11 like a law enforcement matter, he would have had time to launch the second wave. He had a series of follow-on attacks planned, but they were not far enough advanced because he thought he was going to have time and freedom to continue the development of them. And said he was not able to do that, he said, because Al-Qaeda was caught by surprise by the quote-unquote ferocity and swiftness of George W. Bush's response. But then he said something else that was profound. In the end, he said, quote, "We will win because Americans don't realize we do not need to defeat you militarily. We only need to fight long enough for you to defeat yourself by quitting." Unquote. See if this sounds familiar. KSM explained that large-scale attacks like 9/11 were, quote, "nice but not necessary." He was fascinated by the Beltway sniper. Does everyone remember the Beltway sniper in Washington, D.C.? And how he was able to paralyze the nation's capital with very few deaths involved, but just through random acts of sniper attacks. And KSM said he came to the conclusion that a series of low-tech attacks could bring down America the same way enough disease-infected fleas can fell an elephant. KSM said this was their strategy. Jihadi-minded brothers would immigrate into the United States and wrap themselves in America's rights and laws until they were strong enough to rise up and attack us. Then he said the brothers would relentlessly continue their attacks, and the American people would eventually become so tired, so frightened, so weary of war, they would just want it to end. Eventually, KSM said, "America will expose her neck for us to slaughter." That's the 9/11 mastermind. And I think in many ways, he was prophetic. Because for the last 8 years, what have our leaders been telling us? Americans are weary and tired of war. We need to focus on nation building here at home. We need to withdraw our troops from Afghanistan and Iraq and stop spending money over there so we can build bridges and roads over here. And by the way, that is a quote from both Barack Obama and Donald Trump, who said the exact same thing on the campaign trail. We have been defeating ourselves by quitting, just like KSM predicted. But he also warned us that quitting will not bring us peace. He explained, quote, it doesn't matter if we don't want to fight them, it doesn't matter, because we may not be in a religious war with him, but he is in a religious war with us. He said, he and his brothers will not stop until the entire world lives under Sharia law. Al-Qaeda and ISIS have a messianic vision that drives them, of creating a totalitarian Islamic empire, which they call a caliphate, which is supposed to spread all current and former Muslim lands stretching from Europe and North Africa to the Middle East, Southeast Asia, and eventually the entire world. In their vision, everyone must convert to Islam, their version of Islam, or die. Now, they will never see that vision realized, just as the Nazis never saw their vision realized, just as the Soviet communists never saw their vision realized. But we know from history that totalitarians with a messianic ideology can cause a lot of death and destruction in the effort to achieve those aims. And Al-Qaeda has made their intentions clear. We need to take the words of the enemy seriously. One of these speeches that I worked on with the intelligence community with Steve and others was a speech. President Bush called me in the Oval Office and he said, I want to give a speech describing the enemy in their own words. And I want you to drill down and I want you to get the intelligence reports and read everything that Osama bin Laden has said and the leaders of Al-Qaeda have said about what drives them, what their objectives are, what their intentions are. And I want to get some of the stuff declassified, and I want to use what's in the public realm, and I want to describe the enemy in their own words. And so we did that, to describe exactly what Al-Qaeda's intentions were, what their goals were. And one of the points that President Bush made in that speech is that throughout history, our enemies have repeatedly told us what they intend to do, only to have us ignore their warnings. So in the early 1900s, an exiled lawyer in Europe published a pamphlet called What is to be Done, in which he laid out his plans to launch a communist revolution in Russia. The world ignored Lenin's words and paid a terrible price, and he built an empire that almost brought us to the brink of thermonuclear war. In the 1920s, a failed Austrian painter published a book in which he explained his intention to build an Aryan superstate in Germany, take revenge on Europe, and eradicate the Jews. The world ignored Hitler's words and paid a terrible price. And in the 1990s, Osama bin Laden made his intention clear, not one, but two fatwas, declaring war on America. In fact, KSM recently sent a letter to President Obama that was recently released, in which he pointed out, quote, when Sheikh Osama bin Laden, may Allah have mercy upon him, and the Mujahideen publicly declared war against you and your nation, they warned you, your nation, and your allies in plain sight. It's true. They did. The world ignored bin Laden's words, and the result was 9/11. So now the leader of ISIS has made his intentions clear, just like Lenin and Hitler and bin Laden before him, and we still have Al-Qaeda Central and its various affiliates around the world who have also made their intentions clear. And so the question is, are we going to listen this time? Will we stop them before they build the capacity to kill on a horrific scale? Or are we going to ignore their words and pay a terrible price once ahead? Thank you very much, and I'm happy to take your questions.
You can manage the room, but I would ask people to please identify yourselves when you ask a question and please make sure it has that question mark at the end of it.
My name is Steve Gerson. Senator John McCain, who's a victim of torture, has come out against that, and maybe my head is involved in publications, but I guess the conventional wisdom is that torture doesn't work. I guess that's what you're saying is quite the opposite, and I guess I haven't heard that as publicized as I have now. Why isn't what you said more conventional wisdom, that torture does work, let's all get behind it, and
well, first of all, Donald Trump says torture doesn't work. I don't. I don't say it's not torture. What we did, we didn't torture people. What we did, in fact, the CIA went to great lengths to design a program that would fall well within the lines of what constitutes torture, but was coercive and was effective in terms of getting the people to talk. The reason what McCain says is that torture doesn't work because people will tell you anything to get it to stop. Right? That's the argument. When the CIA used enhanced interrogation, was not used to get information. It was used to take someone from a state of resistance to a state of cooperation. So KSM comes in and he says, I'll tell you everything when I get to New York to see my lawyer. He's in a state of defiance. Enhanced interrogation was used to take him from that state of defiance to a state of cooperation. And the way they knew that he had made the move from a state of defiance to a state of cooperation is they asked him questions they knew the answers to. So the only way you could get it to stop was to tell the truth. You couldn't lie to get it to stop. In fact, it was the lying that would prolong the intense interrogation process. So they would know once he started to provide useful information that they deemed to be accurate based on other sources of information, that the enhanced interrogation techniques would stop, and it went to normal debriefing the way you would interrogate any other question, any other detainee. So, you know, there's this vision that we were standing, had people standing over him pouring water on him saying, "Where's Bin Laden?" Didn't happen. That's not how it happened. And enhanced interrogation only happened to about 1/3 of the detainees that were there, and waterboarding only happened to 3 people. Everyone else began cooperating either immediately or they began cooperating after a very light process of interrogation. So why was that necessary? Why was that important to do that? The first detainee that was waterboarded was a fellow named Abu Zubaydah, the first high-value detainee that was captured in the War on Terror. And after he was waterboarded and began cooperating, Jim Mitchell and his colleagues went to him and they said, "We don't want to do this. What else could we do now that you're cooperating with us? What can we do to bring your brothers to a state of cooperation without waterboarding them, without using these techniques?" You know what he said? "Oh no, you must do this for all the brothers." He thanked them for waterboarding him. You know what he said? He said, "The reason was, is that," "you mean we have to waterboard everybody?" And he said, no. Everybody has their level of resistance that they can meet. But here was their philosophy, that they were predestined by Allah to prevail. And so what they told their interrogators didn't matter. What mattered was that they needed to resist for Allah to the best of their ability. And once they had met their level of resistance, they were free to spill their guts and tell us everything they knew, because it didn't matter to the final outcome. They had a religious duty to Allah to resist. And for some people, Allah knows in the person's heart what that line is. And for some people, they can't take anything, and they'll start cooperating right away. And for some people, they are very strong, and Allah knows they're strong, and they can't resist a long time. And Allah will judge in their heart. And also, Allah will judge you if you use more force than you need to. So he knows that what level of force you need to use in order to get that person to cooperate with you. If you do more, he will punish you, and you will suffer eternal damnation for going too far. And so if you know that, they need something to resist. Their religious ideology is that they have to do their religious duty to Allah. Then what do? You can't give them sandwiches and Snickers bars and befriend them. You have to give them something to resist, or at least the possibility that they will have to resist, that they can't take. And so what the CIA did was they designed a series of coercive methods that were started with very mild things like tummy slap, facial hold, and went all the way up to waterboarding, which almost never was used except for 3 very high resistance detainees. And so they gave them something to resist. And as they were applying those techniques, they would say, you know, to Thiessen, "Nobody's gone as far as you have. You've done your duty, Dali. You know that you're going to have to talk to us eventually. You've done your duty." And eventually they would say, "You're right." And they would start cooperating. And so what that shows is that if you're going to interrogate detainees, you have to give them something to resist. Now, it may not be waterboarding. It doesn't have to necessarily be waterboarding. But it has to be something. And many of the techniques were psychological rather than physical coercion. So there was a technique called walling, where they would, you know, Abu Zubaydah said when he met the Red Cross that he was thrown against a concrete wall when he was in his cell. Actually, what the CIA did was, and of course, this would come out, and all of us who knew the classified information couldn't rebut it because the explanation was classified. But thanks to President Obama, he put it out there, so I can tell you. What the CIA did was they built a false wall in the cell that was sort of like a WWE wrestling mat. Have you ever seen a wrestling match where they like throw these guys on the ground and it looks, and they go, "Oh," and they hurt themselves, and it looks like the mat is actually designed to absorb the blow and make a big sound, so it sounds like they're going through a lot worse than they actually are, and it's a ruse. These detainees didn't necessarily see that they were in a room with that wall, with that false wall. And so the low wall would be thrown, they'd put a C collar around their neck to prevent them from getting whiplash, and it would push them into the wall. And it would make a big noise. And they felt like they were going through a lot when actually they really weren't that much. And the idea was to make them feel like they had done their duty to Allah. And then once they did that, they spilled their guts. They gave us incredible amounts of information. And the danger we have today is that why have we been so successful against what President Obama used to call core al-Qaeda, which is the al-Qaeda in Pakistan, but so much less successful against ISIS, less successful against al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula, and some of these offshoots, is because we have a lot of knowledge about core al-Qaeda and how they operate and how they function and what their ideology is and who their operatives are and who their leaders are. And why do we have that information? Because we captured KSM and all these other guys and they told us. We haven't captured ISIS leaders in the same way. We haven't captured leaders. The al-Qaeda and the Arabian Peninsula threat came on after President Obama had canceled the CIA interrogation program. So we had much less information about al-Qaeda and the Arabian Peninsula. Those are the people, by the way, President Obama bragged that we hadn't had a foreign, what was the phrase? It was a very specific phrase. A foreign-directed terrorist attack on the American, successful foreign-directed terrorist attack on the American homeland at his term in office. Well, that ignores the fact that in 2009, a operative from al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula penetrated our defenses, got a bomb on a plane, and tried to blow it up over the city of Detroit. The bomb malfunctioned, thank God. But that wasn't a foiled attack, that was a failed attack. It's only because the bomb malfunctioned. And at the time, the intelligence community the official estimate of the intelligence community was that al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula was focused on regional attacks and did not have the intent or capability to strike the American homeland. Until they did. Why did we not know that? Because we had not penetrated al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula to the same extent that we had penetrated al-Qaeda or al-Qaeda. And so we have all these terrorist networks coming online in the last 8 years, offshoots of al-Qaeda, most of them are connected to core al-Qaeda in the sense that their leaders are people who were from core al-Qaeda and go out to different areas and start up new movements and bring in new recruits and bring in new leadership networks. We don't have the same insight into those leadership networks that we have into core al-Qaeda because we haven't captured and interrogated those people. So we need to start capturing and interrogating ISIS leaders, al-Qaeda and the Arabian Peninsula leaders, leaders of al-Shabaab, Boko Haram, some of these other al-Qaeda offshoots around the world, ISIS leaders from Afghanistan, and finding out what their capabilities or intent is in the same way that we did with al-Qaeda or al-Qaeda.
Can I follow up on that?
Sure.
Yeah. I've got here the report of the Senate Select Committee on Intelligence. I just want to read the audience online.
Yeah.
It says, the committee finds, based on a review of CIA interrogation records, that the use of the CIA's enhanced interrogation techniques was not an effective means of obtaining accurate information or of gaining detainee cooperation.
Yeah.
So my question is, are there CIA interrogation records available to us that can show us that this report is inaccurate?
Yeah.
There are the CIA records that show exactly what the CIA got and who they got it from and how it stopped attacks.
What's the rebuttal to the Senate Committee's conclusion?
So you're a professor, right? So when you write a paper on something, what do you do? You go and interview people. You interview people to ask them about what they did. Like, this is you're doing a report on U.S. policy in Asia. You call to sit down and talk to experts on U.S. policy in Asia. You would interview them and ask them what they did, what policies worked, what policies didn't work, how it was effective. You don't have any CIA officials the Intelligence Committee and the Center for Sun interviewed? Can you give me a guess?
This is based on a review of the interrogation records. That's my question.
How many CIA officials did she interview?
I have no idea.
Zero. Not a single one. She didn't sit down with Jim Mitchell, who's the guy who just did the waterboarding. She didn't sit down with Mike Hayden, who's the CIA director, or any of the CIA directors before. She didn't sit down with Posey Rodriguez, who's the head of the National Clandestine Office, who was the one who helped supervise the program. They didn't talk to a single person. You know why? Because they wrote their conclusion first. This is what you give F to your students, right? You come to your conclusion first, and you go and find the evidence to back up your conclusion. That's what that report did. That is one of the most biased pieces of political propaganda I've ever seen. And the fact is, we know for a fact that this information, in fact, every CIA director, including under President Obama, including Leon Panetta, has said, even John Brennan has said, that program produced intelligence that saved American lives. There's not a single person in the Obama administration or in the Bush administration who worked in the program, who was familiar with the program, who saw that record, who agrees with that.
So you're telling me that in your book, the interrogation records will refute the
interrogation records, and also what I did with Senator Feinstein didn't do is I actually talked to CIA officials. And I find out what happened. All right? I talked to the people who were in the room talking to Khalid Sheikh Mohammed. So I'll give you an example. So Senator Feinstein says, it's not accurate. To read that report is an absolute waste of time unless you want to study how political propaganda is. They picked their conclusion, they cherry-picked information to try and justify their conclusions, and they didn't ask a single person in CIA. Did they interview you, Steve? No. No, they didn't. Did they interview any of your colleagues? Not a single one. So, you know, if your student had produced that report, I hope you would give them an F. Because it's not a piece of research, it's not a piece of intelligence work, it's a piece of political propaganda. And so I'll give you a perfect example of how, so one of the arguments that...
This is interesting. How would you conduct the research without starting with the interrogation records that the CIA itself produced? That I don't understand.
Do you have the interrogation records
that the political committee is doing research?
Yeah. You would read the records, and then you would talk to the program. But I gave you the example of the fact that we have intercepts, but we can't understand the intercept necessarily because we haven't talked. We don't know who the people are. We don't know what the billboards are, et cetera, et cetera. You would actually talk to the people who wrote the records. You would actually talk to the people who were in the room when the interrogations and got the information and ask them, did you get actionable intelligence? If so, how? What did you do? Why was that useful? Why people say that this is not useful? What is your answer to that? They never even asked. They didn't even bother, after they had written the report, looked at the interrogation record, they didn't go to Mike Cage or Jose Rodriguez and say, this is what we found, why are we wrong? And the CIA wrote a rebuttal to it, which I hope you will read, that's also been declassified, which explains all the areas where they got wrong in terms of their interpretation of the record. Now, for example, one of her claims is that the intelligence from the detainees had nothing to do with getting Osama bin Laden. Right? So, and in fact, they say that the name of the courier had already been obtained from somebody years before who was not in U.S. custody.
This is not in the 20-point summary that I've got in front of
you. Okay, this is what Feinstein and her defenders say. So it is true that the name of the courier was in CIA records in an interview with somebody outside of the CIA interrogation program. It was in a list of dozens of people. They have no idea what is important to them. The reason they knew that the courier was important is because they sat down when they were searching for this name, Abu Ahmed al-Kuwaiti, the guy who was with bin Laden's courier, they sat down with Khalid Sheikh Mohammed. They said, "Who is this guy important? Who is he?" And KSM said, and he had been very cooperative up to that time, I said, "Oh, he retired from al-Qaeda years ago. He's not important." And another detainee who they had interrogated said, "Oh yeah, he was very important. He worked for KSM. In a different cell, in a different room." And so they went back to KSM and said, we're told that he worked for you. He said, oh no, that's not true. He retired from Al-Qaeda in 2002. He's not active. They went to this guy, Omar al-Baluchi, who's KSM's nephew. And he said, KSM's lying. He worked for him. I know he worked for him. So then what happened was, KSM was obviously covering up for this guy. So then the detainees had developed a system, which I can't tell you how it works, but they had developed a system for communicating amongst each other, and the CIA had found it. And instead of shutting it down, they left it open and didn't let the detainees know, so they could monitor what the communications were. And so KSM sent a message to the other detainees, protect the courier. And that's how they knew that this was the guy to focus in on. They then started going to other sources of information and trying to figure out what his real name was, and then they tested it against all the vast the network of thousands of intelligence reports and popped up the name of the actual courier, the guy who had been named earlier, but not as a bin Laden's courier, just as an Al-Qaeda member. And then they followed him, and he led us to bin Laden. So KSM lied, but we caught him lying, and that was the signal that said, let us know that he was the guy to go after. And in that book, I detail, and you have to give Steve, you'll have to buy a copy. Sorry. That's Steve's copy.
I'll be happy if you want to
put $5 in my pocket, I'd be happy to take it. But in that book, I detail a series of plots using interrogation reports, using interviews with CIA officials that show point A to point B to point C,
how with the interrogation process led to the capture of individual terrorists who were plotting follow-on attacks. For example, Khalid Sheikh Mohammed, after 9/11, knew that we were going to be on the lookout for Arab men. So he recruited a cell of Southeast Asian terrorists with a terrorist group in Indonesia called Jamaah Islamiyah, led by a terrorist named Hambali. And I can show you in that book from point A to B how the interrogations led directly to the capture of Hambali. One of the terrorists, a good terrorist named Majid Khan, who was in a cell a couple of doors down from KSM, told us that he had delivered $50,000 on KSM's order to Hambali's nephew. And tick-tock, he went. And what we found was that KSM had assembled a cell through Hambali of 19 terrorists who were hiding out in Karachi, Pakistan, including trained pilots whose plot that they were preparing to carry out, though it was not in advanced stages yet because KSM, as I told you, thought he had more time to follow it through. Their plan was to carry out the same 9/11 attack on the West Coast in the Library Tower in Los Angeles, which is now the U.S. Bank Tower. And we captured all 19 of those people, including Hambali and including his nephew, who was one of the leaders of that cell, and took them off the chart. That is stopping a terrorist attack. And there are dozens of examples of that. So it's all in my book. Everybody, you can get a copy and if you want to read it for yourself. I've got the records to back it up, the intelligence report, the interrogation reports, all in there. Yes?
My name is Ross Smith. I have a question about rhetoric.
Sure.
Which is kind of up your alley. In past wars, we've defined victory as being against a place that was no longer capable of mounting an attack against us, whether it's Japan and Germany, or an ideology collapsing and no longer wanting to cause harm to it. The whole phrase war on terror is very amorphous. Mm-hmm. We've defined it as being against radical Islam, but it could also be Puerto Rican nationalists or anybody else that wanted to set off a bomb here in the U.S. And so my first question is, why did the Bush administration choose the phrase war on terror as opposed to war on the caliphate or declaring war against al-Qaeda? And second, how would you define victory?
So those are really good questions and really hard questions to answer. The war on terror was, I think, designed to, because this wasn't a war like other wars, it wasn't a war against a nation state. So in a way, we were very lucky with the 9/11 attacks and the sense that our adversary attacked us before they had, most of the adversaries we faced in history have been nation states, right? And so what you have is the process of somebody, a radical leader comes up with a radical ideology, slowly takes power, consolidates power, takes over a country, takes over a great power, usually like Germany or the Soviet Union, Russia, and builds up a massive army and then goes on an effort to conquest around the world. The terrorists, the Islamic radicals, I think Islamic radicalism would be a better phrase than terror per se, the war on Islamic radicalism. I think that's how the Trump administration is referring to it now. They don't use the term war on terror. Islamic radicals reversed that process, and they attacked us before they had taken over a great power. What you see in Iraq and Syria now is an effort by ISIS to build a power. So they want to take over a great power, which is the Iraq, Babylon. They want to take over Baghdad. They wanted to build the caliphate in Iraq and build that state, and then use that as a base from which to conquer the world and build their caliphate. And they're doing what Al Qaeda didn't do, which is trying to take control of a nation state. And now we're pushing them back and driving them out of their strongholds. And they will probably end up reverting to what Al-Qaeda is now, which is a very dispersed underground terrorist network that is going to try and attack us the way Al-Qaeda did on 9/11. So it's a different enemy, and so the traditional rules and the traditional rules of war and the traditional ways of fighting war don't apply. So for example, people ask, why did the Bush administration not give them Geneva Convention protections? Right, when they capture terrorists. What are the purposes of the Geneva Convention? The Geneva Conventions are not designed to protect detainees, they're designed to protect civilians, right? So you create laws of war, and if you follow the rules of war, if you don't target, if you wear, the rules are you have to wear uniforms, carry your weapons openly, not target innocent civilians, and follow the laws of war. And if you do those things, when you're captured, you get privileges of how you're going to be treated. If you don't follow those rules, you don't get those privileges. So what does Al-Qaeda do, or ISIS do? They don't wear uniforms, they don't carry their weapons openly when they're carrying out attacks in the West. They hide among us, and they hide in plain sight and attack men and women and children. So this is an enemy that was not contemplated when the Geneva Convention, the laws of war, were written. So the irony is that to give them Geneva Convention protections would actually be counterproductive to the purpose of the Geneva Conventions, because it would teach people that you can get those protections even if you don't follow the laws of war. So this is a different kind of adversary. And people say, indefinite detention? You know, we're going to hold these people for 50 years? We only hold German prisoners for 4 or 5 years, and then the war ended, and you release them, right? That's what you do with prisoners, right? The reason we don't release them is because they haven't surrendered. Germany surrendered. Japan surrendered, and we gave them back their prisoners. Okay, we can release everybody in Guantanamo tomorrow if ISIS and Al-Qaeda just sign a surrender document and lay down their arms and stop trying to kill us. As long as they're trying to kill us, we have a right to detain their detainees. And so you have these new paradigms of war that we've never had to deal with. In a way, we're lucky because the Soviet Union posed an existential threat to us. Soviet Union did. Nazi Germany posed an existential threat. Al-Qaeda and ISIS could very well pose an existential threat if they ever get their hands on weapons of mass destruction. And that's the big threat we face. But we're lucky that we engaged them. Imagine if we had engaged Hitler in the 1930s instead of the 1940s when he was weak, before he was able to fill Auschwitz and all the camps with millions of people. It would have been a lot better. That's what we've done in this war. It's only because they attacked us before they were ready to withstand what we were going to throw at them, and because they miscalculated, because they thought, you know, that we were not going to respond in the way we did.
So what is your vision of victory?
Vision of victory is there's not going to be a signing ceremony on the deck of the Missouri, right? So there's never going to be a surrender. So there's never going to be a clean victory. The victory is when terrorists are not able, do not have safe haven from which to plan successful attacks on the United States. So that means we have to eliminate their safe havens. President Bush's standard was pretty clear. Terrorists should be allowed to have no safe haven anywhere in the world from which they can threaten the United States of America. And so that how I design victory is denying them safe haven from which they can plan attacks. Now that's also more complicated now than it was in 2001, because in 2001, the model for terrorist attacks was, okay, we get a bunch of people, we bring them to Afghanistan, we train them, they jump over hurdles, and we train them and all the rest of them, and we deploy them through Europe, Germany, onto planes, into the United States, and they carry out their attacks. Today, the model is, we get them on internet chat rooms while they're already in the West, and train them via secure communications, and give them marching orders. There was a great New York Times front page story in the New York Times a couple of days ago. It said, there are no lone wolves. The myth of the lone wolf terrorist. That in fact, most of these attacks that are seen as lone wolf terrorists are in fact involve detailed communication and planning and direction from terrorists abroad. And so it's a lot harder now. Just taking away their safe havens actually isn't enough. We have to disrupt their communication. We have to disrupt their ability to radicalize people and communicate with people. So it's very hard. There's no clean definition. I wish I could give you a very easy answer. If I could give you that answer, then we'd have beaten them by now, I think. Yes.
Yeah, so I remember the 9/11 report talking about a failure of imagination. So let employees go free. What do you consider the biggest 5 threats in the U.S.?
I just listed a whole bunch of them at the beginning of the talk, so I don't know that I can do better than Hayden and John McLaughlin and Steve Slick in terms of imagining those things. I mean, I think...
Within the U.S.
Within the
U.S. Like, dirty bombs somewhere.
So, interesting thing that Jim Mitchell, who again is the guy who talked to Khalid Sheikh Mohammed for thousands of hours, in his book he describes how KSM would sit there and regale him with ideas for attacks. He really was a mastermind. He would come up with the most ingenious ideas for terrorist attacks that were perfectly feasible, right? But because he was in a CIA black site, he couldn't communicate with anybody and share those ideas, right? So it would be an incredibly dangerous thing if Khalid Sheikh Mohammed was ever allowed to communicate with the outside world. Because if he was able to communicate with the outside world, he would sow seeds for 1,000 attacks in this country that are easy to do. It takes a guy, a couple people, you know, with a good idea. He was thinking less and less about 9/11s, though he still cared about those things. But so his idea for after 9/11 was that what they were going to do, if we had not invaded Afghanistan and taken him out, his plan for 9/11 was he had a plan for a series of low-level attacks that would overwhelm our response capabilities and distract us while he planned for the West Coast bomb, for flying the plane into the Library Tower in Los Angeles. And so there were going to be, he was going to have, and in fact, he infiltrated operatives into the country who were going to, the goal was to blow up gas stations along the East Coast. And he had even purchased a gas station in Pakistan and had designed and been working on how do you design a bomb that could actually penetrate into the tanks and blow up gas stations. And so this is very far advanced and very well designed. And he was unable to carry that out, thank God. But the idea was a bunch of low-level attacks, distract them, and then go for the big one. Now the big one, he said, not necessarily that important if you have enough of the small one. So the KSM vision for how they get us, if they ever are successful, if they ever have somebody as smart as KSM in figuring these things out. And I can't tell you what they were. Jim won't share that publicly, though he's told me a few of them. But they're very ingenious, and they're very simple, and you and I could carry them out if we wanted to. It's not very hard. We are very vulnerable. And it's interesting. I have a theory. I don't know if Steve agrees with it or if the intelligence community, if other folks in the intelligence community agree with it. But one of the reasons, everyone always wonders, why did they bomb the Mall of America? Why didn't they do some of these things? And I think part of the reason was they actually didn't expect the 9/11 attacks to be as successful as they were. They didn't expect the buildings to come down. And it was so successful, and it raised their profile so much, that if you follow that up with like killing 5 people in the Mall of America, people look at you and say, oh, the war on terror's working. You're weaker, right? So I think they kept looking for the big fight, the big attack, because it would have been an admission of weakness, an admission that they had been set back if they couldn't replicate or at least come close to replicating 9/11. ISIS has no such compunctions. Mow down 100 people on the beach in Nice, that's a success. Kill handfuls of people in Paris or in Brussels in the airport, success. So ISIS is not encumbered by the spectacular success of the 9/11 attack in terms of its reputation. Anything that it carries out is considered a success. So I think as we get further and further away from 9/11, the acceptability of low-level attacks as a strategy becomes much more dangerous. Yes?
My question really had to do with what is ISIS now? Was ISI back in the surge? Mm-hmm. And had to take, my understanding was that you needed to take the radicals out, which they were effective at. Mm-hmm. They were still lethal, but not effective, mm-hmm. in order to have the Sunni awakening, wouldn't you?
Yeah, so in the surge, the surge was very effective to the point Jack Keane was in Iraq. He's very close to General Petraeus. He's the guy who designed the surge. He saw the intercepted communications where Al-Qaeda in Iraq was sending out a message to report Al-Qaeda and others saying, stop sending the foreign fighters, we've lost. Don't send any more foreign fighters. Now, that's not the message they're sending out now, to it, but they broke with Al-Qaeda. What happened was they were down to about, according to Obama's CIA director, John Brennan, they were down to about 700 people. And they had lost all of their, they had lost all the territory they controlled, they had lost all their safe havens, they had lost all their bomb-making factories, they had lost all of their weapons depots, and they were not having any foreign terrorists coming in. And all of a sudden, we pulled out our troops, took our boot off their necks, and they turned Syria, they moved into Syria, and turned Syria into a Grand Central Station of Jihad, where thousands of people came from all over the world, tens of thousands of people, to train with them and fight with them. And now those people have been deployed.
I have one other question that, one of the things I always wondered about was the triggers for the IEDs were made in Iraq.
Okay? So the Shia militias, yeah.
Why didn't they take that Afghanistan? That's what I never understood.
Some of us wanted that too. That's a very typical decision, but in order to do that, you have to launch a military attack on Iranian territory. There was a point in time where we found that Syria was building, with the help of North Korea, was building a nuclear facility, and we didn't want to take that out, and the Israelis did it.
Yeah.
We didn't want to take the risk of launching an attack on Syrian territory, and I think for whatever reason we decided as a matter of prudential judgment that it was better not to launch an attack on Iranian territory. I think we probably could have launched a covert attack on Iranian territory and denied it and let them see if they wanted to mention it or not. The Syrians pretended it didn't happen when it came to the nuclear facility. I suspect the Iranians would have done the same thing, but that wasn't the decision that was made. Yes?
I asked you how you would envision us responding with the new administration, not just the new president, but you know General McMaster, you know General Mattis, you know the others. If one of those events that you listed off at the beginning of your talk, you can pick one, if it occurred 6 weeks from now, what in the pit of your stomach do you think is the way America would respond?
Well, I think Americans, the American people or the government?
Well, both. We're in a strange time where in the last 6 weeks we've had a member of the House and a member of the Senate each take secret trips to Syria, for example.
Yeah.
So, you know, how did Washington respond? Let me ask it that way.
Well, let me answer what I think the American people would respond. So America, you know, we kept hearing that Americans are tired of war, we don't have the stomach anymore for fighting anymore. And President Obama, after ISIS rose up, didn't actually for the Iraqi government was asking him for at least 6 months before they came in and took over Mosul to launch airstrikes against them while they were in their massive forces in the Iraqi desert in the western desert of Iraq, and he refused. And he calculated that Americans didn't want to get drawn into another war in Iraq. Pulled out, they didn't want to come back. And so he did nothing. And Al-Qaeda in Iraq / ISIS. Came in, they took over Mosul, they took over other cities, and then they started beheading people. And they started beheading Americans. And Americans saw that, and whatever chip in their brain had that reminded them of 9/11 kicked in, and they said, go do something. And the polls started showing they wanted him to act. And so then he acted, right? And started to act. And then when that wasn't working, Americans started saying, we want ground troops. And so he started putting in ground troops. He was following public opinion. But what was fascinating to me about that was how quickly Americans shifted into a mode of, let's go get these guys. When they started killing Americans, when they started putting up those videos, that Americans haven't forgotten 9/11. And one of the things when I started my talk, I talked about how Steve and I would collaborate on these speeches. The reason President Bush gave those speeches all the time was because he thought it was important that he needed to continue to ask the American people for their support and explain to them what was at stake. And for 8 years, President Obama stopped doing that. You never heard him talk about the stakes. What was at stake, right? President Bush was always very focused on the consequences of victory, but also the consequences of defeat. What happens if we lose? And in fact, there are even quotes that after ISIS was risen, where he predicted exactly what happened if we withdrew prematurely from Iraq, down to the letter of what actually took place. He laid out, here are the consequences of defeat, and he laid it out. They'll take over territory, they'll start killing Americans, they'll start taking over oil fields, and all the everything that happened, he said. And President Obama, one of the jobs of the commander-in-chief is to use your bully pulpit when you're at war, and we know this going back to FDR and the fireside chats, that's the job of the commander-in-chief in a democracy when you're waging wars, commander-in-chief in a democracy, to ask the people for their support and to report to them regularly on the progress you're making and to explain to them what's at stake and what you're doing to carry out our military action in their name. And President Obama stopped doing it. And so support waned because people weren't getting those reports from the commander-in-chief. So I would hope that in this administration, I don't know what's going to happen in this mission. Anyone who tells you they know what the foreign policy of the United States is going to be going forward, they know more than I do. I don't think you're interested in what the foreign policy of the United States is going to be going forward. He's still trying to figure it out. But I would hope he said, we are going to destroy radical Islam. It's a big goal. Warms my heart. I hope he does it. But if he's going to do that, he's got to ask the American people for the support. And he's got to explain to them how he's going to do it, what his strategy is when he gets one, and explain to them the stakes in the fight, the consequences of victory, but also consequences of not doing what he's doing, and regularly report to the American people. And if you do that, another lesson I learned from Donald Rumsfeld is Americans have a pretty good inner gyroscope. And if you explain to them what's at stake, you explain to them what the options are, they'll choose the right course. So I hope that that'll happen and that he'll do that before we have to respond to another attack that we didn't expect. Yes?
Mark, for what may have to be our last question
sure.
of the day, can I steer you back towards an intelligence topic, unrelated to the ones you come to?
Sure.
So during the Obama administration, I remember you quite creatively made an official records request and obtained the statistics for President Obama's participation in his presidential dinner.
Yes.
There was some controversy about whether you had the numbers right and what it all meant.
Uh-huh.
But you were, of course, critical of him for not placing a high enough priority on absorbing daily work in the intelligence community. And we have a new president now.
Yes.
And not only his declarations of hostility for this community, but I think there's a similar record developing there in terms of how often he makes himself available. Now, David Priest, who was with us last week, would argue that presidents in our history have had different relationships with intelligence. They all consume data, in their own individual way. And the community has to adapt to that. So how do you feel about this now, this business of measuring and judging how often or how deeply a president interacts with his intelligence community? Is that really appropriate in your mind?
Absolutely it is. And I think that George W. Bush had it right. He took his presidential daily brief without fail 6 days a week, no matter what, come hell or high water. He was traveling, he would take his briefer with him, like Burrell. And that's the right way to do it. No one actually challenged my numbers. The numbers were accurate. They challenged whether it was whether that showed that he was being intelligent. Seriously, President Obama says, "Well, I read my intelligence, right?" And then of course they put out these great stories in the press about how he's the master of the intelligence brief, and he uses an iPad, and he's so smart, and isn't he wonderful? And they ignored the fact that he's skipping half of the meetings. So yes, you can read it on your iPad, but you could have given me a bunch of documents about the CIA interrogation program, like Senator Feinstein got a bunch of documents. But you thought it was important for me to sit down with the people who actually ran the program to really understand, so I could ask them questions, so I could challenge their assumptions and see if I'm understanding it correctly. And I was just a White House staffer. I wasn't the president. When I talked about the need for interrogation versus just getting signals intelligence or intercepts, one of the reasons is that you can't ask a signals intercept a question, right? It's the same thing with the PDB. You can't ask a document a question. You can't ask your iPad a question. There's a classified version of Siri.
Maybe
I don't know. Maybe Siri has a top secret SCI clearance now. A version of her that can answer all these questions. But the importance of the daily brief in person is that, one, it gives the president an opportunity to probe and ask questions. And two, those questions give the intelligence community an understanding of what the president's priorities are and how better to serve him. So like one of President-elect Trump, when he was saying this was, they keep telling me the same thing over and over again, and now I need to listen to the same report every day, 5 days a week, right? Well, if you actually go to the brief, it won't be the same report every day, 5 days a week, because they'll learn, this is what he wants to hear. The kind of information, not necessarily the answers, but the kind of information he's looking for. What are his priorities as Commander-in-Chief? What threats is he focused on? What kind of information will serve him better? So it's an interactive process that didn't exist under Obama in the same sense that it did under Bush. And I think it's especially important for someone like Trump, and was also especially important for someone like Obama, who had zero experience in these kinds of issues, national security questions, especially Trump, who's never even been in government. Obama at least was on the Foreign Relations Committee, got classified briefings, had some experience. Trump never had a classified briefing until a few months ago. And doesn't have a deep knowledge of national security threats. So I think it's incredibly important. So I'll hold Trump to the same standard I held Obama to. And I will report in my column in a certain time to be determined after I've looked at the same record request for President Trump to see if he's taking his intelligence brief every day. And if he's not, I'll smack him on it just like I did President Obama.
All right. Thank you.